Architectural, engineering and construction projects can be chaotic. The question is, do they have to be? In the right hands, level of development can act as the brain of a project and help us manage the chaos. Keep watching to understand how. I'm delighted to have you with us. I'm Rick Aspin and this is V&RB, where we'll collaborate with you to define the design process of the modern world. Our initial series will explore the relationship of level of development and design management throughout the process of building information modelling and virtual design and construction. So why start here? Well, imagine you needed a medical operation that carried a lot of risk, and you're offered two surgeons who can perform the surgery for you. The first will use 2D x-ray imagery that provides a basic understanding of the patient's anatomy. So the second surgeon will use new technology. It will provide 3D imagery that allows him a much more realistic and accurate understanding of the patient's anatomy. He will also be able to use this imagery to plan ahead for the surgery and its execution. So the question is, who would you choose? The same goes for design. The use of new technologies and processes allows us to precisely manage our way to better execution of our projects. And this leads to much healthier and cost-effective life cycle for our buildings throughout design, construction, and operations. We're going to take a deep dive into how we can create an open and inclusive project environment where the skills of every discipline are the focus of creating and managing a realistic project schedule. Using the BIM Forum's LOD specification, we'll show you how the LOD matrix can be used to document and manage the project's goals and tasks. Today, we'll start with an overview, but in the coming weeks, we're going to dig real deep into what it takes to manage a design project. Now make sure to stick around until the end when we'll share our LOD matrix with you, and we'll also explain the name Vellum and Razor Blades and what it means. But in the meantime, please leave us a comment. We would love to hear your point of view of the content today, and also if you've had any experience managing projects with LOD, and what successes and failures have you had. As mentioned, the design process is as complex as ever. In my career alone, production techniques have evolved from drawing boards, pencils and ink to CAD, and now to three-dimensional building information models. New materials and technologies and greater emphasis on sustainability have added complexity and the need for quite varied and specialised knowledge. Building information modelling and virtual design and construction are a powerful combination of tools and processes. They can significantly enhance collaboration and the quality of coordination, but not with ease. It is critical for clients and professionals alike to be open, inclusive, and willing to learn and adapt to new strategies and technologies. And if we do, everyone can benefit enormously. With a collaborative mindset, we can design and build better for less, and maybe even have more fun and free time doing it. The B1M is a channel I follow and respect immensely. Its aim is to educate and inform how great the construction industry is. In the video linked below, Fred Mills makes some critical points that V&RB will discuss solutions for in following videos. Fred explains, producing information that is unnecessary, confusing, not structured properly, poorly coordinated, and or difficult to find has been found to add about 20 to 25% onto the cost of delivering our built environment. Having greater integrity and taking care of how we structure our data can eradicate this waste from the process. The suggestion is that if our teams can gain clarity and understanding, this can lead to time and cost savings. The important point here, though, is that this approach requires more discipline, not more work. It is worth bearing in mind, it's not how fast you start, but how quickly you finish that matters the most. Effective use of our time during the project kickoff phase is vital to laying the foundation for success. The most valuable asset of any project is its people, and design and construction needs a ton of them. A project's foundation relies heavily on each person excelling in their own expertise, but more importantly, it relies on their understanding the needs of others. With understanding, we add rocket fuel to the project as the team seeks win-win scenarios in an open and inclusive, collaborative environment. The BIM Forum has completed outstanding work in delivering the LOD specification. This expands on the LOD schema developed by the American Institute of Architects and breaks down all project elements by their UniFormat and OmniClass numbers. We can use these to define and manage tasks required in each area of expertise, including ownership and responsibility at each phase of the project. as the design process transitions through phases of definition, discovery, exploration, and final documentation, an ebb and flow of expertise is required that can include hundreds, if not thousands, of people, all required to sing from the same hymn sheet. And it is here that we must plan and manage our way to hitting the target of maintaining a single version of the truth, to reduce the risk of costly duplication and errors. The level of development lies at the very centre of the team's unified understanding of project success and promotes proactivity over reactivity. The level of development is shortened to LOD, which is sometimes referred to as level of detail. The BIM Forum provides the following explanation in regard to this. LOD is sometimes interpreted as level of detail rather than level of development. There are important differences. Level of detail is essentially how much detail is included in the model element. Level of development is the degree to which the element's geometry has been thought through. The degree to which the project team members may rely on the information when using the model. In essence, level of detail can be thought of as input to the element, while level of development is reliable output. It is important to note that the international terminology regarding level of development and level of detail varies. Some countries refer to the level of development concept defined within the BIM Forum specification as the level of detail and use different numbering systems. The target of V&RB is to come as close as we can to defining the idealistic design process. This will provide a great starting point from which any project team can take their first steps and begin to manage each individual project for its own unique and specific needs. I would anticipate any of the global systems fitting in with this approach, but finding out will be part of the fun of discovery and collaboration. The LOD matrix allows us to define the LOD progressions and responsibility for each element at each phase of the project. As an example, concrete elements such as columns, walls, beams, and slabs form the bone structure of the design. The architect is initially responsible for their spatial coordination in the design, while the structural engineer guides the sizing of the elements until they reach LOD 300. Achieving LOD 300 means the superstructure is fixed with the coordinated size and location of all elements and allows for a responsibility handover between architect and structural engineer to take place. Using precast concrete T-beams as an example, the BIM Forum's LOD spec expresses the LOD progressions similar to below. LOD 100 may have the beams represented by a generic spatial zone, modelled to their worst case depth. LOD 200 has the structural grids defined accurately, and the structural elements are modelled with approximate worst case dimensions. LOD 300 requires the accurate size and specification of elements, including all sloping surfaces to be accurately modelled. LOD 350 includes the detailed coordination of pour joints, expansion joints, embeds and anchor rods. Shear reinforcings, stud rails and areas of rebar that require close coordination are modelled, and permanent forms include penetrations for items such as MEP. And critical structural zones, such as areas that cannot be penetrated, cut or damaged, are also modelled. LOD 400 represents fabrication level information and includes all reinforcement, including post-tensioned elements detailed and modelled with cambers. LOD 500 represents the as-built state of the project. It allows for a digital twin deliverable for management during facility operations. The methods, tools and needs of LOD 400 and 500 vary immensely for each project, and this will be discussed more in future videos. From this example, we can understand the importance of collaboration throughout our team to define our what, who, where, when, why and how. And it's obvious that this understanding needs to be achieved very early in the design process. As a side note, you've likely heard of a building information model being referred to as an LOD 200 or 300 model, but this statement is a fallacy. Model elements are developed in a similar approach to the construction sequence. The superstructure should be fixed first, reaching its LOD 300 status. This allows the likes of exterior envelopes and interior architecture to react and then be fixed at their LOD 300 status. Following this, interior finishes will follow suit. It's important to understand the leap between LOD 200 and LOD 300. LOD 200 allows some flexibility in the location and the sizing of elements. LOD 300, on the other hand, is 100% spatially coordinated. It is common for an LOD 300 or 350 model to realistically only achieve the LOD 200 status. The design team should be structured appropriately with the correct expertise to achieve the project goals. We will review this in detail over the next few weeks as we take a deep dive into coordinating the LOD matrix between all disciplines. The 20 to 25% of cost savings suggested in the B1M's video are surely worth instilling the discipline required for a successful finish. V&RB is excited to work with our growing community, and we look forward to providing a trusted resource that will grow organically with more input. The one thing we must remember is that we only get one chance to start on the right foot. And once out of the gates, it's very challenging to recover from a bad start, and haste certainly does make waste. Before we summarise, remember we'll be sharing our LOD matrix for you to download, and we'll also be explaining the name Vellum and Razorblades. In summary, we've discussed the importance of using level of development in the management of design projects. We've seen how LOD can act as the brain of the project and help us manage the chaos. We've also discussed how new technologies and processes can help us manage our projects, leading to a healthier, more cost-effective lifecycle for our buildings throughout their design, construction, and operations. The BIM Forum's LOD specification and the LOD matrix are powerful tools that can help us document and manage a project's goals and tasks. In the coming weeks, we'll be diving deeper into the fabric of what it takes to manage a design project. The essence of this video is in this statement. It is this that allows our team to understand one another and function as a single fortified unit. The LOD matrix can be found at the link below. This provides an overview of LOD progressions and ownership, but we will be developing this further with community input over the following weeks. We would love to hear your comments on the matrix and the rest of our content today, but before we go, let me explain the name Vellum and Razorblades. When I started my career, vellum was the material of choice for producing drawings, and this was originally made from prepared animal skins, which makes me sound rather ancient. And although I have a milestone birthday coming this year, I can promise you I'm not that old. The modern paper vellum that I used when I started my career was actually a plant-based synthetic material. And the story of razor blades, well, they were used as erasers. Let me explain. So in those early days, there were a few steps to the design process. Step one was to design in pencil, so we could erase it easily, make design changes. Step two, we would ink the final design in with rotary pens. And we all know with the design process, there's always design changes. And so step three, when we did have those design changes, was to take a razor blade and scratch off the surface of the paper along with the ink that we didn't wish to have anymore. Now the next trick was, rub your thumbnail on the inside of your nose, which would gather the oil from your nose and resurface the paper. This would prevent in the next step, when you re-inked the drawing, from the ink running on the sheet. So of course, you can only scratch out so many times in the same area of paper. Planning was critical, and the undo button didn't exist. So vellum and razor blades is a nod to those early days in the industry. But I've kept myself on the forefront of technology and processes. And that's why I'm excited to be here to collaborate with you to define the design process of the modern world. Of course, this is a gigantic project, but I'm excited to work with a community of like-minded people who want to make the most of today's potential in design. Please jump on board, and if you're unfamiliar with the level of development, there are links below for further watching between now and our next video. So this is Rick Aspin checking out. If you want to learn more about me, you can find a link to my career resume below. Thanks for watching all the way to the end, and please give us a thumbs up if you like the content. Also, don't forget to hit the subscribe button if you want to be notified for all future videos. Thank you so much. We appreciate your time, and we'll see you soon.